Okay. So tell me, in general, what your treatment was like. You weren't getting tortured. What was happening to you?
Well, the torture for all POW, especially those up in North Vietnam, ended in 1969 as word got out of the misuse and abuse of the POWs up there. So because I was captured somewhat later in the war, President Nixon was taking 10,000 troops out of Vietnam a month, and there was roughly about 180,000 to 200,000 troops left. So they went to extreme measures to capture us alive so that they could use us, one, for bargaining, and to show the world when we were released that we've taken good care of your POWs. We're humane and lenient people. We didn't ask for this war. You invaded our country. Okay? So we get to Cambodia, and there's only 27 Americans held, service members held in Cambodia in three different camps. We didn't know about the other two camps until 2 days prior to our release. So we thought we were the only ones in Cambodia. Started with three of us. When we were released, there were seven in this particular camp. So when we walked into this camp, there are five tiger cages, 5 by 6, made out of bamboo trees, 10-foot chain attached to them. The other one went to my ankle itself. Now, was I physically beaten and abused? No. Was I psychologically, inhumanely treated? You betcha. Everything from lack of medical care, food, the opportunity to write home, to receive packages as provided for in the Geneva Convention, which they did not recognize because they were not a signature to the Geneva Convention. And so they play these little psychological games on you. For example, when I was first interrogated, they'd give me some propaganda material to read. And when I had my first interrogation session with this guy, I walk out there, and I'm sitting on this little tree stump about 6 inches off the ground, because that's where they told me to sit. And so when this guy comes out, he's sitting at this bamboo wooden table with a chair. And as soon as he sits down, because they are short-statured people in general, I have to look up to him. Okay, I got this one. I'll give you one. And so we go through this little, who are you, where are you with, and so forth and so on. Now, this guy is speaking English fluently. And I asked him later on, I said, where'd you learn to speak it? Off BBC radio in Saigon as a kid. And so under the code of conduct, you're supposed to give name, rank, and serial number. Well, that's been modified since because it didn't hold up over there. So you give general answers. Well, I was with this unit, make up another unit that you're not associated with. So then he starts to try and break it down. Well, were you this year? Were you here? And I'm thinking to myself, this guy's done his homework. He knows his stuff. And as I've talked to especially the service members out at Berkshire, when it's Air Force Base here, their code of conduct is don't ever, ever underestimate the enemy because they will know more about you than you know about yourself. So we get to part of the interview, and this goes on for about an hour and a half or so. He said, what'd you think about that book or booklet that you read and everything? I said, well, I have to disagree with a couple of points because some of the battles that you mentioned in there that you won, I was there, and you guys did not win. And he looked at me in all seriousness and says, oh no, you've been misled by that propaganda machine we've got in this country called the free press. And that's when communism finally hit me. The system's based upon lies, amongst other things. Because they told us also that if you tell, even if it's true, you repeat it 1,001 times, it becomes false. And when that guy looked me in the face and said, oh no, you're mistaken. Even though I was there, he wasn't. He still believed they won.
He actually believed
He
it.
believed it 100%. And I saw them withhold medical care from people that had evaded capture. That was actually in the same vicinity where I was, but he evaded for 30 days. Withheld food and clothing and shelter, from this guy. They just threw him on the dirt floor in this cage. Didn't give him a hammock like I had, a mosquito net like I had to kind of protect me from the mosquitoes and malaria and stuff like that. And the rationing of food and the psychological games. One time they just came to me for no reason that I knew of and took me down to the other end of the camp and put me in an underground bunker that just the only air we had was a little 2x3 grate door. And I was in a bunker underground that was snake infested. And I stayed there for about a day and they let me out. So there was no rhyme or reason.
Say that last part again about the bunker.
It was the bunker was an underground snake infested bunker with about a 2 foot by 3 foot grate, locked gate on it. The only ventilation we had to the upside of it and so forth.
And when you say bunker, a lot of people don't know what you're
Well,
talking
it's
about.
Like in this particular case, like a hole in the ground that was just big enough to have a hammock in there to stretch the hammock out and stay in that hammock. And it was probably about 3 feet tall. and about 5 feet long.
But, so you couldn't stand up?
No. Didn't want to stand up because I didn't know what was below me. Snakes or, scorpions or whatever.
So you just hung in the hammock?
I just hung out in the hammock until they came and got me and put me back in the cage I'd come from.
How long were you in there?
In the underground deal?
Yeah.
2 days. And then I spent 6 days of my 6 months in my solitary confinement in internment in solitary confinement, which didn't bother me too much because I'm an only child. But when we walked in and there's three of us, there's five cages. I'm in a cage by myself, and the other two are put in a cage together.
How far away from you are they?
We're probably about 50 feet apart. Now, we weren't supposed to be talking to people in the other cages because we're guarded, 24/7 by a teenager or less with an AK-47. And you can't escape because one of the things we'd be challenged with is getting off that 10-foot chain. Second challenge, if we got that far, is you can't go out through the fence behind you because there's punji stakes. So you'd have to go out.
Which means pointed sticks.
Pointed sticks, about 3 yards deep, just, inches apart. So you couldn't run through there, step over them or something like that. It'd puncture your foot. And so you had to go out in one of the entrances. Now, we did meet a guy in Washington, D.C. when we went up there for the deal that President Nixon had for us that was actually in that camp and escaped. And I said, how'd you ever get off? James Sexton was his name. How'd you ever get off that chain? Well, when he was captured, he was wearing a retainer. And every night over a period of time, he whittled on that link with that retainer, broke the link, got out at night, thought he was going the right direction. Because when you get on the Ho Chi Minh Trail, you have to stay on those trails. They're maybe 12 inches wide, and everything else is triple canopy. And it's like a spider web, it's not a straight line. So, let me turn here, let me go there. I think I'm going the right way. An hour later, he came on the other side of the camp.
Same
not,
camp.
Not a good day.
Yeah.
Not a good day. So that confirmed us that if we had tried to escape, we probably would have met the same fate that he did. It would have been very difficult.
You mentioned snakes in the bunker, but you also had experience with snakes in the cage, right? Tell me about that.
My first experience, I'd been there probably 2 or 3 days, and I'm sitting there in my hammock. Now, we're supposed to play what I call the Mother May I game. They say, anytime you go in or outside this cage, in Vietnamese, you're supposed to ask the guard permission. May I come out? May I go in? So I'm sitting there one morning, and I see something moving on the side of the cage, and I slowly turn my head, and here's this black cobra snake. Now, what are we supposed to do when you see a snake? Stay put. Well, I didn't have any senses at that time, so I just kind of, got myself out as best I could, did not ask the guard for permission, got him over there. Of course, the snake had, gone away. But daily or nightly on any given week, they would kill some of the most venomous snakes in the world, the crate snake, the green bamboo viper. Bite you 2 seconds later, you're dead. So I was more afraid of snake bites and dying from that than our own military Air Force that would bomb around our camp every few weeks, which was confirmation to us that they knew where we were.
You mentioned two snakes then. What were they?
The crate snake and the green bamboo viper.
C-R-A-T-E?
I think so.
Yeah, crate snake.
Yeah.
Venomous, both of them.
Very,
yeah.
Very.
All right, eventually the war ended. You got out. You made your way, as I remember hearing it, through several steps.
Right.
I want you to skip forward until you reach that point where you had the opportunity to meet your parents for the first time.
When we were released, we went through Saigon, got a commercial airplane through the Clark Air Force Base. The first communication I had with my parents, of course, was by phone. The first time I met them face to face was at President Lyndon Johnson's medical suite at Fort Sam Houston. Mrs. Johnson was kind enough to allow us to use the president's suite up there, so I stayed in Lady Bird Johnson's room, the president's room on the other side. And when I landed at Fort Sam Houston, myself and Colonel James Ray were the first two Texans back Valentine's Day of 1973. So we landed at Kelly Air Force Base. I got on a helicopter and choppered over to the old Fort Sam Houston hospital, BAMSI. And got off there, they picked me up, put me in a car, take me to the hospital, and this is like 2:30 in the morning or something, and the door opens and there my parents are. And one of the pictures in these exhibits is me greeting my parents for the first time, and really over a year, or about a year and a half, because I went back for my second tour of duty for 7 months, captured 3 days before discharge, spent another 10 months, so I didn't know they were gonna be there or what the drill was until the doors opened, and there they were, so it was a very emotional time in my life.